Welcome to Paul Ricard for the second race of the weekend in the Formula V8 3.5 Championship. We had a tremendous race yesterday, won by the Russian driver Igor Oruchev, who in so doing became the first double winner of the championship season. And he was chased home by Roy Nissany and René Binder. Today's race is 40 minutes plus a lap like yesterday, but it has the mandatory pit stop to look for as well between laps 5 and 15. So we've got the pit stops to look forward to make today's race even more dramatic. Up until yesterday, we'd had 6 races and 6 different winners. We've had 6 out of 7, but with Roy Nissany yet to win on pole position, it could be that we do have a different winner again in this race. So we've got the cars doing the installation lap round onto the grid. It's a very hot day here, track temperature over 41 degrees, and it's going to be a hard race for the drivers, that is for sure. Yesterday's race was led briefly by Mathieu Vaxivière, but he had the wrong setup on the car, so that started to affect the tyres, and he started to drop back, and it means that he's fourth in the championship behind Aurélien Panis. Louis Delatraz second, and Tom Dillman is still the leader, but the winner yesterday, Igor Oruchev, up to seventh now, making good progress, good point haul with that second win of the year. So race two of the weekend coming up. They've been to Motorland Aragon, they have been to Hungary, they've been to Spa, now to Paul Ricard, and the cars head towards the grid, ready for race two of the weekend. David Addison trackside, looking forward to what promises to be a really good race. If anything, like yesterday's, it should be an absolute stormer, and the pit stops are going to just shuffle the order even further. The race just running a little bit behind schedule by about 5 minutes. That's why the cars are still making their way round onto the grid. The cars, all Dallara built chassis, everyone has the same. They've all got the same Renault 3.5-litre engine. Without Renault support, a slightly different name these days, hence its new title of Formula V8 3.5. But the cars still look good, still sound good, still give good racing. And the teams that you've got are proper teams, the likes of Arden and Lotus and AVF and Fortec and the RP Motorsport team and Durango as well, are all teams with a great pedigree in single-seater racing. And there's a huge amount of support for the series as well. The likes of Richard Dutton, for example, of Fortec, still a great believer in this championship. And there aren't many single-seater categories that Richard doesn't have an involvement in, whether it's from F4 in the UK up to this championship that's just one level below Formula One. And as the cars work their way round to the grid, it's going to be the Lotus entry of the Israeli driver, Roy Nissany, son of one-time Minardi tester Hanok Nissany, for pole position. And it's going to be Igor Oruchev, yesterday's winner for Arden, the SMP Racing colours carried by Oruchev. And there he is, going through up towards the grid now. He's going to be the man on the outside. Yesterday, he was third on the grid and led into turn one. His start was just stunning. If he can do that from the outside of the front row, then he's going to be very hard to beat in this race. We've got, I think I'm right in saying, one car that's just come into the pit lane, but the pit lane will close. It's in 5 minutes, so he is okay to do another installation lap. The more you do, the more you help to scrub in tyres, so it's worth doing if possible. And there, heading to the grid, is one of the two AVF cars. Alfonso Chalice and Tom Dillman are the two drivers for AVF by Adrian Baez. Adrian Baez himself was the runner-up to Sebastian Vettel in Formula Renault 3.5, and did that in his rookie year as a 19-year-old. So the grid formed, or forming, and then of course they'll have one final warming up lap to put some warmth into the Michelin tyres, and then we are going to be good for 40 minutes plus a lap around the circuit. So 22 laps that we had yesterday, that's going to be the target. Roy Nissany, the man starting on pole position, and Roy Nissany, having done that great effort this morning, found time afterwards to have a word with Blanco de Foronda about his pole position lap.
So we are with Roy Nissany and Lotus in a fantastic last minute lap.
Yeah, unbelievable. It's a great feeling, maiden pole in the category. It's been a while, and it was a great lap combined, because from the beginning of the weekend, from Friday, I felt great with the car on the track, and after to Saturday on the podium, so it continues and even upgrades. So of course I'm happy starting from pole position looking forward for it.
And Roy, we can consider you're half French, your mommy is French, you have a French passport, so we can consider this is half your Grand Prix today.
Probably the reason for the first pole. I really feel like home. France is my second nationality. My mother is French, my family is French, so I'm still working on my French, so excusez-moi pour mon français. But yeah, it does feel like home, and I think the results are showing it.
Okay, good luck for your race. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So Roy Nassani, having graduated from Formula 3 to what was Formula Renault 3.5 last year, taking his first pole position. And now that the cars have made their way round to the grid, just one or two last minute adjustments if need be, just to get the absolute right setup on the cars. Now, we've talked about some of the teams. I mentioned Fortec a moment ago. Richard Dutton is the brains behind Fortec. He's on the grid, ready to speak to Blanca.
Richard Dutton, thank you to join us in the grid today when the Formula VA 3.5. A lot of champions in your CV, 20 drivers have been champion in your... Today you're dealing with Fittipaldi and Louis de Trav, one of the best rookies so far.
Yeah, it's exciting. It's always hard to win championships with rookies. But as you've seen so far, we're doing a good job. We're second in the championship and we're going to keep fighting until the end and hopefully we can win another championship.
Formula VA 3.5 is your flagship championship. Six programs in all. How did you deal with all this great organization, Richard?
I'm very lucky. I have some really good people around me and each team has its own manager. So I'm sort of, I can cruise and let them get on with it.
Of course, Brexit was on the paddock on Friday morning. You woke up and it's a different, completely situation in your country now. Did you feel any silver feelings that?
Well, first of all, shock. Of course, a big surprise to us, but we have no idea how it's going to change things. And we'll just keep on pushing on as normal and carrying on supporting your championship here, because it's a wonderful championship. And we'll just carry on as normal and keep pushing.
Thank you very much, Mr. Dutton. Good luck for today's races.
Thank you.
And we're moving into Bob Babrick, team principal of Lotus. A very successful racing weekend so far. 2 and 3 yesterday. Today in the pole position.
Yes. Hello. Hi. Everything went very well so far. Yesterday was really, really nice. Double podium we doesn't have, I think, from last season. So, and the pole today was again really, really good. So the team is mega happy until now.
So maybe Roy Nissany is heading to his first victory. Lotus is one of the most experienced drivers in the Formula Renault 3.5 series. Can this moment be like a benchmark for your new targets, new assets in the last part of the season?
Of course, we're looking forward. So I hope we get it. What we push so hard, and of course will be also nice for the next season. We're looking again, so better results mean of always better drivers, and yes, that's it.
How is René Binder, a GP2 refugee here in the Formula VA 3.5? How is he dealing with the adjustment and the team and the race performance so far?
Actually, he adapted very well. You can see yesterday as the example. And from race to race, we just build up another V8 driver, very strong driver.
Okay, all the best, Mr. Babrick. Thank you very much
for joining us.
So two of the key team principles there. Richard Dutton's point about Brexit is a relevant one because, of course, at this level, you are dealing with teams competing in foreign championships, dealing with international organisers and dealing with international drivers as well, and the budgets, therefore, are different as well. So, you know, you're thinking of euros and sterling's value against it, and it does have a big impact on teams racing internationally. Brake fire on the grid a moment ago. That was Igor Aruchev's car that had to be attended to. And so the winner of yesterday's race having a bit of a scare on the grid, and hopefully all is well. But the Russian driver with a last-minute worry that he could well have done without. It's one way of warming up your tyres, I suppose, but not in the ideal format. So Igor Aruchev then, ready to go. We'll get the formation lap underway in 5 minutes' time. So it's 3:10 local time. Just running slightly behind schedule, but as soon as possible, we'll get the cars released onto the green flag lap. yesterday's race was one of changing fortunes. Things were happening all the way through the race. The entry this weekend, 15 strong in terms of entries, and there's a huge amount of support. You heard Richard Dutton saying about supporting a fantastic championship, and there are plenty of other teams that want to stay in with the RPM organisation that looks after this series, and it delivers excellent racing. One of the drivers that's graduated from 2 litre to 3.5 litre power for this year is there, Louis Delatraz, who is the top rookie on the grid, qualified third in fact for this race. So Louis Delatraz, who didn't really shine yesterday, will be one to watch here, I suspect. Roy Nissany on pole position, as we've been saying, you've heard. Also with him at the front of the grid is Igor Arudjev. Delatraz lining up for third on the grid, and then fourth is a man who started yesterday in the pit lane, having stalled on the grid, another of the SMP Russian driver development program cars of Matavos Isakyan. Then next on the grid, it is going to be number 8, which is Aurelien Panis, and then René Binder to line up 6th on the grid. In the second of the Lotus cars, there is Aurelien Panis, the son of Olivier Panis, who was here on the grid yesterday to cheer on Aurelien, of course team owner as well as a proud racing dad. There is René Binder, whose father Franz used to be a racing driver, but his uncle Hans Binder was briefly in Formula 1 for a time. And then on the next row of the grid, you've got number 15, which is Alfonso Celis, and Tom Dillman, his teammate, is next on the grid. There is Alfonso Celis getting himself ready to go. The grid now being cleared at the 1 minute board. The engines will fire up and the last engineers will leave the grid. It'll be one warming up lap. Yesterday's race was actually 38 minutes plus a lap in the end because of the need to do an extra formation lap. We had a car stall on the grid, namely that of Isakyan. And so we got the race delayed, an extra formation lap. But because of that lap and the fuel tank, so you need to take one off the distance of the race itself. So it became 38 minutes plus a lap. So we should be on for about 24, 25 laps maybe once we get underway here. Now, Yu Kanemaru, who had qualified at 5th, having all his lap times disallowed, he is going to be allowed to start from the back of the grid. We haven't had confirmation as to what infringement it was that has put into the back, whether it was track limits or a technical infringement. We'll try and find out, but that car put to the back of the grid, and Yu Kanemaru, the Japanese driver, will be one to watch, I think, trying to tiger his way up through the field. And there is Yu Kanemaru. Now, his father's business in the area of Japan affected by the earthquakes recently, and so they are the tribute on the side of the car to all the people, particularly the workers in his father's business, affected by the earthquake in the area. And Yu Kanemaru driving for them in his European racing campaign. He drives for Tia Martin Motorsport, the experienced Spanish team, and remembering those affected by the events in Japan. So the grid formed and the 1 minute board is shown. Engines now fire up. The grid is to be cleared. 1 minute to go to the start of the formation lap. And we will get the race underway very shortly indeed. So the cars in a moment will be released onto this formation lap. Last chance to get some warmth into the Michelin tyres. The setup for Mathieu Vectivier's car yesterday was what did for him, but in this race, it's not a great qualifying position either. 10th only. Roy Nissany doing his qualifying time right at the last knockings of the session to get up onto pole position. Vectivier will be one to watch, so to try and tiger his way through, having struggled really to get a lap together properly in qualifying this morning. So the car's about to be released. The race officials on the grid will have control to release the cars any second, and as soon as that command is given, everybody will blast away. The green lights go on onto the gantry. These cars still make a fantastic noise. They sound like racing cars should sound, and so away they go and blast down towards turn one. At the back of the field, Yu Kanemaru, whose car was underweight, hence it was a technical infringement that meant that all the lap times were disallowed from that car. He has been allowed to start the race. Yu Kanemaru will be worth watching, I tell you, because he's a very rapid driver. Kanemaru, who has, from memory, not been on the podium this year, but is still quick enough to challenge to four places and should make progress. 40 minutes plus a lap is quite a long distance. Roy Nissany then, his first pole position alongside yesterday's winner, Igor Arutyunov. Third on the grid, Louis Delatraz, son of Jean-Denis Delatraz, and Mathavos Isakian alongside him. Aurélien Panis, son of Olivier Panis, is fifth on the grid, and René Binder is sixth, ahead of Alfonso Celis Jr., and Tom Dillman, the championship leader, only eighth on the grid. Ninth, Mathieu Vexivier, with work to do. And then lining up 10th, it is the car of Vitor Baptista. 11th, Pietro Fittipaldi, the grandson of Emerson Fittipaldi. And alongside him, it is going to be Arturo Llanos with Bites Cavissa and Giuseppe Cipriani on the final full row. Row 7 with Yu Kanemaru on his own at the back of the grid. Everybody got away onto the formation lap okay. Didn't have that luxury yesterday. Aurélien Panis was a bit slow away, so he was forced to start in the pit lane. And then he was joined by Mathavos Isakian, who forced the delayed start. So as the cars worked their way under the watchful eyes of the engineers, Fortec have found somebody to point at. The cars now up towards Senior. They use the chicane, so the Mistral straight is broken up a little bit, but it does, of course, give another overtaking opportunity up the inside, heading down towards the braking zone for the chicane. Turn left at the chicane north, then it's right and left again, back onto the Mistral straight. Kanemaru at the rear of the field there in the Tio Martin Motorsport car. He'll be a man to watch. And the field out of turn 11 with this spectacular scenery in the background. Glorious sunny day as well. A bit breezier than yesterday, so if that's going to have an effect on anything, it might just affect aero. We'll wait and see. But the cars, certainly yesterday evening when the wind had picked up a bit for the GT race, were having a tailwind, pushing them down to Senior, giving them a bit more speed. But we'll see how that pans out, whether it's going to affect matters now as we get set for the second race of the weekend. So we're just about set. The teams, of course, have more of a part to play in this race because there is the pit stop where you have to change two tyres, so either two fronts and two rears, and we'll see how those pit stops make or break the race for certain people, because if you get it wrong, or pit at the wrong time, or pit in traffic, then you could well be in strife. It's a part of the race where you can lose out markedly. Up towards the grid they come. To the grid they come. Roy Nissany, pole position then in the Lotus colours. Whip at the front of the grid, Igor Arutyunov. Then third on the grid, Louis Delatraz. You saw perhaps when you were peering into the cockpit earlier, the yellow overalls, underlining that he's part of Renault's driver development programme. Fourth on the grid then, it is Mathavos Isakian, lining up fifth, Aurélien Panis, and then sixth, René Binder. Seventh to the grid, Tom Dillman, the championship leader. Sorry, seventh to the grid, I should say, is Alfonso Celis. Eighth to the grid is Tom Dillman, the championship leader. Ninth is where you find Mathieu Vexivier. And the drivers then are into position. As soon as Yu Kanemaru gets to the back of the grid, there'll be a green flag shown to say that everybody is in position. There it is. The drivers now will look towards the lighting gantry. Five red lights will go on. Lights go out. Now, blast off. Great start by Arutyunov, just like yesterday, to get up on the outside line, down towards turn one. They're going to go wheel to wheel, but on the inside line, Roy Nissany tries to hang on to the advantage. Vexivier bouncing over the curb on the inside as he tries to gain track position as well. But through turn one, is it going to be Arutyunov or Nissany that comes out ahead? It's Roy Nissany. The Israeli driver leads the way, so as he heads down towards turn three for the first time of asking. A very good start indeed made by Roy Nissany. He leads as they break then through turn three. He's got Arutyunov in second place, and then Louis Delatraz going after them in third spot as they work their way then now out of turn five for the first time, being forced out a little bit wide though, one of the SMP cars. Mathieu Vexivier runs in the SMP racing colours, even though he's the first non-Russian driver so to do, because it's very much about bringing on Russian talent. Mathieu Vexivier, the French driver, runner-up in Formula Renault 3.5 last year, on a mission then as he tries to gain ground. There he is with the red, white and blue colours, the red camera mount on top of the car as they break now for the chicane for the first time. Three wide, that's not going to work surely as they scramble into the corner. It doesn't. Something has to give, and the Tio Martin Motorsport car gets squeezed out wide at the escape road, out of the chicane. Lap one, Roy Nissany trying to get the opposition here as they power their way now up towards the right-hander of Senior for the first time. A challenge made on the inside line there, but not quite being able to make a move was Yu Kanemaru trying to work his way up the order. So Kanemaru from the back of the grid doing his level best to make progress. So Roy Nisani leading the way as the cars wriggle their way up towards the end of lap number one. Everybody with a good clean start, nobody having to start from the pit lane today, unlike yesterday's race, as they're losing out a little bit in 21. That's the RP Motorsport car of Arthur Janos. Heading now through Virage du Lac for the first time up towards the end of lap number one. And already there are little battles developing all the way through the field as Roy Nisani is trying to shake off Igor Arutyunov, and he in turn has got Louis Delatraz hunting him down. The leader goes through with a second in hand already. So Nisani leading the way. Arutyunov is second. Third, it is Delatraz. Panis is fourth. Fifth is Binder. In sixth place, Vax Rivière. Seventh is Dillman. Eighth is Issa-Kyam. In ninth place, it is Fittipaldi. And tenth is Baptista. 11th is Chelis. 12th, Kanemaru. 13th is Bites Gavissa, the only female driver on the grid. 14th is Janos. And 15th is the hotelier and restaurateur Giuseppe Cipriani, one-time Formula Palmer Audi Formula 2 racer. So we're on lap number two, and Roy Nisani leading by 11/10 of a second when they work their way up past the pits. Can he get away, or is he going to be caught? We'll wait and see. The race leaders accelerating onto the Mistral straight for the second time. Bear in mind that this race has that pit stop to factor in as well. Roy Nisani then now down towards the chicane, chasing after him Igor Arutyunov. Yesterday, one or two drivers being a bit more mindful of tyre preservation than others, and that stood them in better stead towards the end of the race. So there, Mathieu Vaxivière goes through at the moment, being able to fend off the challenge of Tom Dillman in the Dayglo car, the orange AVF by Adrian Valles run car. Through senior they go now for the second time, and in the first sector Arutyunov quicker than Roy Nisani, in the second sector quicker than Roy Nisani. So the gap's coming down between the top two, there they are, but also going with the top two is Louis Delatraz there in third place. In fact, if anything, Delatraz is closer to Arutyunov than Arutyunov is to Nisani. Working their way up now towards Virage du Lac to end lap number two. And Delatraz trying to go after the Russian driver as Roy Nisani, looking for a maiden win, turns his way up towards Virage du Pont. Brakes, goes down through the gearbox, turns through that very tight right-hander, back into a straight line, back onto the power. You see what happens behind there, because Aurelien Panis put the power down just a fraction too soon and the car tried to get away underneath him. Over the timing line goes Roy Nisani, 1.2 seconds to the good. Second Arutyunov, third, almost hidden there is Delatraz. Fourth and fifth together, because up the inside tries to go René Binder in the second of the Lotus cars, but Aurelien Panis, son of Monaco Grand Prix winner Olivier, fends him off as they run now down towards turns 3, 4, 5, the next sequence, down at the very bottom of the circuit, and that takes you to the end of the first sector of the lap as well. Through they turn, nose to tail there for fourth and fifth places, and then behind them is Mathieu Vaxivière, who should be making a bit of progress now. Arutyunov, though, quicker in the first sector than Roy Nisani, so the lead gap just down ever so slightly as they work onto the Mistral straight now. Making the run up towards the braking zone into the chicane. Roy Nisani leads the way. This is going to be a fascinating test of Roy Nisani, because he's leading and on target perhaps for a maiden win. We'll wait and see, but it's a different kind of pressure now, knowing that he's got to stay there for virtually the whole race still, knowing that he's got some very quick drivers all queuing up behind him, knowing that he's got to make a pit stop and not make a mistake on arriving at the pit box or leaving the pit box. So for Nisani, a really different sort of race that he's got to drive, and he's got to soak up all of that pressure race long now. Arutyunov still running in second place. Third is Louis Delatraz, and they're getting away from the Panis-Binder battle. There it is, fourth and fifth. Mathieu Vaxivière not really staying with them for the moment, in sixth spot. Vaxivière really frustrated yesterday when the setup of the car started to chew the tyres, and he ended up in fifth place. It could have been a whole lot worse, actually, but it was a pretty good save. So the field working its way up towards Virage du Pont, making their way now towards the timing line. Tom Dillman, championship leader, running in seventh place. He's raced here, but only on the short circuit in the past when he was in the French Carrera Cup. So still learning a little bit about what Paul Ricard is all about in its full configuration, full Grand Prix circuit, if you like. As there is Louis Delatraz. Dad Jean Denis, we used to see in GT racing, but he had a brief spell in Formula One prior to that. And Louis already part of not only Renault's driver development program, but also signed up for BMW and doing the German GT Championship with them. So Delatraz in demand in a way that his father perhaps wasn't, but Louis came out of the Formula BMW Talent Cup a few years ago, spent a few seasons in Formula Renault 2-litre, but last year was a real standout year and has carried that momentum forward now into Formula V8 3.5 and into his GT racing as well. And when you've got two manufacturers sniffing after you, it's got to be good news, surely. Race leader Roy Nissany then up towards the chicane, still being pursued by Igor Oruchev, who was quicker in the first sector, but it looks as though Delatraz is getting back onto terms now with the Russian driver for that second place. Igor Oruchev, who began in karting, had a spell in French Formula 4, as you look there at Pietro Fittipaldi trying to hang on to a place. Vitor Baptista is the man he's fighting with, and they fought yesterday as well and ended up making contact down at turn 5. So they'll try and avoid that today, as right round the outside goes Baptista. Very brave stuff. Is he going to hang on to it? Yes, he rides the curb way, way wide. In the background behind them was Yukanamaru, but a really bold pass that by Vitor Baptista round the outside at senior. Got to be brave to do that, and Baptista is brave in capital letters. So he's gained the place away from Fittipaldi, up into 9th spot he goes. Heart rate back to normal for him, and now he presses on. The next target is going to be the rather fading Matevos Isakyan, because he was fourth on the grid, but he's dropped way, way down the order now. The leaders work their way over the timing line. At the end of lap number 4, the gap is 1.6 seconds. Roy Nissany has done the best lap of the race just now and is continuing to extend the margin over Igor Oruchev. Then in third is Louis Delatraz. Now, the lap that Delatraz has just done was a 53.2, no, in other words, not as quick as Igor Oruchev. So the gap's opening up ever so slightly, first to second, second to third. Is there a mover further down that we need to monitor? Because, yes, just slightly. René Binder there closing fractionally onto the back of Aurélien Panis. So there is Panis, working his way down towards turn 5 in the Arden International colours, in the Lotus colours, René Binder. And René knows all about powerful single-seaters. He's raced in Formula Renault 3.5, he's raced in GP2. He also had a spell in the one-mate, one-team MSV FIA Formula 2 Championship for the season back in 2011. He's raced in the German F3 Championship. So an experienced driver is René Binder, hunting down Aurélien Panis, who came out of French Formula 4 through, a bit like Louis Delatraz actually, 2-litre Formula Renault racing, the Alps and the Euro Cup Championship. And he's got experience of these cars, Aurélien Panis, because he was 12th in Formula Renault 3.5 last year. So the race leaders then spring their way up through senior. And again, Oruchev in the sectors looking really, really good, because he's quicker in one and two than the man he's chasing, Roy Nissany. But there is still a long way to go, because we've got still 31 minutes plus a lap to run. So drivers in these temperatures thinking about the longer picture here, not wanting to stress the tyres too much. You can change two of them, of course, but you need to make sure that the rubber is going to be fresh towards the end. So it could be a different dynamic after the stops compared to what we have now. If you're going to change the tyres early, run a used set and then put the fresher tyres on to give you that extra pace in the second part of the race after you stop. So there, up towards the timing line, comes Tom Dillman. He's got Isakyan behind him, and into the pits indeed comes Tom Dillman. So he is the first of the pit stoppers. Tom Dillman then, down the pit road. That's at the end of lap 5, as soon as the window opens. So in he comes, and he will rejoin potentially in last place. And they're going to change the rears on Dillman's car. Back into the race he goes. What this does is get him out of traffic, of course. It puts him to the very back of the pack. But what he might be able to do now is a sequence of qualifying equivalent laps, and therefore bring himself back into the game once all the stops have cycled through. So Tom Dillman, the Frenchman, the championship leader. Somebody else has got a long CV, having been a Formula Renault racer 12 years ago. He started off, had a long, long spell in Formula 3, former German Formula 3 champion. And then just when it looked like his career was going nowhere, he had a season in GP3 and then got into GP2 and then was 7th in Formula Renault 3.5 last year. We've seen him in GT racing as well, and he's also done the French Carrera Cup. So he actually, while the career was trying to work out which way to go, proved his versatility, and that put him back on the radar because people thought, oh, he's good in that kind of car, we'll give him another punt. He was briefly part of Red Bull's programme as well when he was in Formula 3. Tom Dillman, as he turns his way then now up from what's going to be 15th place back into the race and will need to really push to try and make sure he gains track position after the pit stop. So who else is going to be in? Who, if anybody, will come in at the end of this lap? There's Roy Nissany. So do you get your stop out of the way early and go a long way on the fresher tyres, or do you stay out to the end of the window? He's staying out. Laps 5 to 15 are when you can do the stop. There is a car diving for the pit lane, which looks like Panis. So Aurelien Panis moves from the outside line, the racing line, to pit in. And at the end of lap 6 then, Aurelien Panis comes down the pit lane. All teams getting ready. And let's see what they do to Panis. Is it going to be fronts or rears? It's the rears. New boots on, drop the car down, away they go. And Pietro Fittipaldi is the other that has come in. Rear tyres for him as well. You see a pattern emerging here, don't you? So early stops we've had. And over the timing line will go Giuseppe Cipriani. And Tom Dillman comes through, and it looks like he's going to lose out on the stops. He will certainly stay ahead of Fittipaldi, yes, but he doesn't get ahead of Aurelien Panis. So, no, he stays where he was, effectively, ahead of Fittipaldi, behind Panis. So he's not really benefited through stopping early. Maintains track position over Pietro Fittipaldi in the Fortec car, but doesn't manage to jump up ahead of the Arden car of Aurelien Panis. As now, out of the chicane come the two race leaders. Roy Nissany, at the start of this lap, was 9/10 ahead. Interestingly though, Dillman, now that he's got fresher tyres on the back, has done the absolute best final sector on the previous lap and the absolute best first sector on this lap. So Dillman is certainly pushing. Great little battle going on there. Mathieu Vetsivier trying to go through and stave off the challenge of Issa Kian. So the two SMP racing cars getting themselves together. We've got Vitor Baptista up behind as well. So this is for now 5th, 6th and 7th places. 27 minutes plus a lap of the race to run. Vitor Baptista with that really brave move to get past Fittipaldi, now trying his luck with the SMP racing cars. Roy Nissany comes out of the Virage Dupont, doesn't pit, nor does Orujev, nor does Delatraz. So the three leaders, covered by 2 seconds last time, go through. Nissany has just done another fastest lap of the race, 2.4 seconds covering the top three now, so the gaps are widening just a little bit across those three cars. Fourth place is still Binder, there he is looking a bit lonely. Fifth in the background is Vatsivier, and that means that Issa Kian and also Mike Kavissa are into the pit lane. So that's at the end of lap 7. In comes Issa Kian, rear tyres, what a surprise, and 26 is in as well, Mike Kavissa, and that's rear tyres for the Dutch girl as well, blasts back into the race. So Tom Dillman through, Aurelien Panis through. There is Fittipaldi making his way up towards the line. Arthur Janos also has pitted, number 21. I'm guessing it's going to be rear tyres because that's what we've seen from everybody else thus far. But that's the race leader, Roy Nissany, making his way then now onto the Mistral straight with Igor Orudchev close, but not close enough to make a move. And Delatraz thinking about making a go of this now, because Delatraz has just done the absolute best middle sector. So perhaps pushing, thinking that it's pit stop time imminent for him. Delatraz, the Swiss driver, starts to up his pace. There he is swooping his way through turn 11, through De Bosset, and then up towards turn 12 here, Bendor. So the lead gap greater than the gap second to third. Delatraz chipping away, getting up onto the tail of Igor Orudchev. Louis Delatraz hard at work there, trying to get himself back into the equation in the Fortec car. Kind of forget that he's a rookie, but he's the leading rookie. The second of the rookies is Vitor Baptista, and the third of the rookies is Mathavos Issa Kian. Into the pit lane comes Delatraz then, at the end of 8 laps, and he comes. So that is the highest placed pit stop we've seen thus far. In other words, the most important so far. Rear tyres again, so third he was running. Lights up the rubber as he blasts away. Louis Delatraz here can smell a podium finish. He's had a win this year. He won first time out at Motorland Aragon at the start of the year. Since then he was third in Hungary and he was third at Spa, but wasn't on the podium yesterday. He looked a little bit anonymous yesterday, sixth, but he was still the winning rookie. Out on track now goes Delatraz. And in the background also, Vatsivier has pitted. You just saw the SMP colours going down the pit lane. So Vatsivier, again, I would propose his rear tyres being changed. There in the pit lane as well is Giuseppe Cipriani. rear tyres going on his car. Back into the race goes the Torcello SRL car. So Cipriani, car operated by Durango Racing Team, another crack squad in international single-seater racing. He rejoins the race, but still we haven't had first or second in Nissani or Marouchev, but Cam Delatraz jumped them on the pit stops. He was pushing hard anyway, wasn't he, before he came in, but let's see what his lap times are going to be like whilst the other two stay out there. We're approaching the halfway point, and you can go to lap 15 before you need to think about a stop. So depending on how the drivers treat the rubber and how they're going to play this, you either start with fresh and go on to used and try and divvy it up accordingly. Might be another lap or two, but let's see, does Roy Nissany go for the pit lane? No, he doesn't. He's making a long stint out of this, and Igor Arutyunov pretty much shadowing him here. So the Israeli driver leads the Russian over the timing line. Both of them with Formula 3 experience. Igor Arutyunov was a race winner in British Formula 3, and it's original incarnation, its dying days really, of a couple of years ago when it was a rather modest grid, but he arrived at Silverstone first time there, won a race, and then last year moved into Formula Renault 3.5. He was fifth at the championship. As into the pit lane now comes 22 Vitor Baptista, so that's nine laps done. Rear tyres, and away he goes. He'll cross the timing line in the pit lane, as out on track Roy Nissany goes onto the Mistral straight now, still trying to build this advantage over Igor Arutyunov. But after a rather difficult time in Formula 3, Nissany moved to Formula Renault 3.5 last year, 13th in the championship, and seems to go better, in fact, in these more powerful cars. Formula 3 have always been regarded as a bit underpowered and aren't everyone's cup of tea. You do find drivers that struggle a bit in those and then move into more powerful single-seaters and develop far better, and Roy Nissany could well be one of them. He's had a pretty decent season as well, with a second place in Hungary and a second place here yesterday. And the Lotus mechanics are getting ready. Now, do they bring Binder in first or Nissany? Nissany is crucial. Binder could be a guinea pig to make sure they can do the stops okay. And up and down the pit lane, the mechanics are they ready to do their work or now studying the data to see what effect the stop has had. Louis Delatraz has done the absolute best in the first sector. René Binder has done the fastest lap of the race. So still fascinating to see the different pace of the cars, as there is the leader, Roy Nissany. Is he in this time? No, he's not. He's got Igor Arutyunov chasing after him as they work their way up past the pits and then look back for third. René Binder, does he go over the line? Does he head for the pit lane? He is in. And also still being shown as in the pit lane is Vitor Baptista. Now, I thought we'd seen him blast away, but maybe there's a problem down the pit road. There's René Binder coming in. So that was 10 laps, that stint for Binder. Rear tyres, and away he goes. Now, can he jump ahead of Louis Delatraz here on the stops? That's the next question. There's Nissany, Arutyunov shadowing him. Delatraz threw Binder back on track. And Delatraz has just done the fastest lap of the race. So straight out of the box on new rear tyres, Louis Delatraz does the fastest lap of the race in the Fortec car. So for Richard Dutton's team, a good effort being put in by Delatraz, as there, heading up towards the chicane and going straight on is Roy Nissany. So the race leader makes a mistake and will blast away, but where does that leave him in relation to Igor Arutyunov? The gap's probably pretty much the same, because all those cones put in to make sure you don't gain an advantage. He slalomed his way through. So Roy Nissany makes a mistake, misses his braking point, doesn't fight the car, doesn't risk a spin. He continues, threads his way through the cones, carries on in the race. And let's see if the race director is content with that. So Nissany makes a small mistake. He's under attack now as well, because the gap is down. Arutyunov was 1.6 seconds back. He's much, much nearer now. And that is Vitor Baptista's car. It did have a problem in the pit lane. It did leave its pit box, but has ground to a halt heading down the pit road. There's the race leader. So Nissany trying to regroup now after that mistake. He comes up towards the timing line, still being pursued by Igor Arutyunov. He goes up towards the timing line now. Through he goes, and the gap has come down. It's only 0.9 of a second between those two. Now running third, also yet to stop, should be Alfonso Celis. So he's a long way back. to being given that third place by others making their stop. So yes, Chelis is a further half a minute back now. Sorry, no, 15 seconds back rather, in third place. Up to fourth from the back of the grid, yet to stop, is Yu Kanemaru. And then we need to see where the best placed of the pit stoppers is. And it's Delatraz, who's just got over the line in fifth place. So Louis Delatraz is 29 seconds behind the race leader. Let's see how much of that 29 seconds he can erode by some demon lap times before the top two make their pit stops, because he was almost up with them, wasn't he, before the stops began. Nisani this time gets it right coming into the chicane. Arugia still pursues him, and the gap was up a fraction in the first sector. Yesterday, Urushev's progress was just mind-blowing, but today he's not really being able to respond to Roy Nisani in quite the same way that you might have anticipated for RP Motorsport, trudging away Vitor Baptista. So that's the first retirement of the race. Day over for him. Great noise these Dallara Renaults make. 3.5 litre engines, the V8 engine that they all have, the Dallara chassis, for Dallara having really conquered the market for junior single-seater racing over the last few years. Did have a spell as a Formula One constructor, of course, when it ran cars for BMS Scuderia Italia in the 1990s, and the Renault 3.5 litre engine, Michelin tyres helping the cars, and the very successful package that the teams have had a handle on for a few years now continues to be a popular one. Over the line goes Nisani. Arugchev is 11 tenths of a second back. They swoop their way up towards turn three. See the gap there as well. See all the extra runoff areas with the painted runoff to slow the cars down as you run over that painted section in the French national colours. Of course, a very patriotic place nowadays, Circuit Paul Ricard. Over the line there goes Louis Delatraz. Right, he's 28 seconds behind. So because he's on fresher rubber, his lap times now are better. And therefore, the hope is that because of being also away from traffic, running in clear air, and doing these very good qualifying-esque laps, he's going to be able to jump one, maybe two, on the pit stops. The leaders, last time through, 152.6, 152.9. Delatraz, 152.1. So he was, from memory, 2 seconds back before the pit stops. He's hacking away into that deficit. So Delatraz, once everybody has made their stops, could have gained himself one, maybe even two places. Look at the gap now. It's a phony gap because of the pit stops, but you can see the advantage the top two has over Alfonso Chelis there, who runs third as the cars work their way up towards senior. Behind Chelis is Yu Kanemaru, yet to stop. So he's come up from the back of the grid, running in fourth place now. And then Louis Delatraz, fifth. Aurelien Panis is sixth, René Binder is seventh, Tom Dillman is eighth, so he pitted early, but it's not benefited him hugely. Ninth is Fittipaldi, and tenth is Bites Gavissa. The race leaders come out of Virage du Pont, with into the pit lane coming Arugchev then from his second place. So Igor Arugchev comes in, and now we need to see whether he's going to be able to hang on to second place relative to Louis Delatraz. So number seven, Igor Arugchev, at the end of 13 laps, comes down the pit lane. And it's going to be rear tyres. Right, there is Delatraz up towards the Virage du Pont. So we keep an eye to the track, an eye to the pit lane. Arugchev gets away, burns rubber as he blasts off down the pit road. But of course, he's got to obey the speed limit. Delatraz, foot to the boards, comes through and will go past. So he gains second place in real terms. Louis Delatraz, and by some margin, gets ahead of Igor Arugchev. So Louis Delatraz up on the pit stops. He's just done the absolute best last sector as well. He'd already done the fastest lap of the race. So Delatraz gains one place on the pit stops. Can he gain two? That's the next question. So now they've seen how it's panning out against the car of Igor Arugchev, the Arden car, no doubt Lotus. Now we'll have a think about the strategy, but it might be too late to change it for Roy Nisani. His last lap was a 53.0. Delatraz a 51.8. I reckon he might get the lead of the race as well on this evidence, because he's been chipping away. And you saw the margin he had over Igor Arugchev. It wasn't a slow pit stop, that far from it. So there's Roy Nisani. Can he hang on to the race lead? It looks a little bit unlikely the way that Delatraz is going. But then, of course, Delatraz will have to go further on those rear tyres than will the race leader now, Roy Nissany, because he's pitting later in the race. So it might be that late in the race, it starts to balance out again and Nissany can fight back, assuming he loses the lead in the first place. But we're into the last 14 minutes now, plus the one regulation lap tagged on at the end. Is Nissany going to be in this time? The Lotus pit up at the top end of the pit lane as he works his way now up towards the pit lane. So, race leader is in. Is he going to come out as the race leader? Let's see. Roy Nissany, pole position, has led the race for 14 laps. In he comes. And there's only one other car, Alfonso Celis, now to make a pit stop. So, this is the most important. Yeah, the race leader is in. Roy Nissany for Lotus, up on the jacks. Rear tyres go on. Drops down, blasts away. There's Delatraz. It's going to be close. He's got the momentum. He's on the pit straight. But, of course, don't forget that having to drive all the way down the pit lane is Roy Nissany. He's still ahead. He's still ahead. He can't cross that white line. And Delatraz takes over the race lead. So Louis Delatraz, by pitting early and doing very, very good lap times, takes over the lead of the race. And Nissany actually is under attack from Igor Aruche for second place. So Louis Delatraz is the race leader as predicted. The battle is on for second spot with Arutyunov now looking for a way past the Lotus car, but Fortec managed it perfectly. Were they knowing smiles in the garage? Either way, it is a Fortec car leading the way, and not only does Delatraz lead, but the lead's building because of this battle for second place. Nissany straight away is in a battle, having to fend off Igor Arutyunov, and that all means that whilst they're tripping each other up, so the lead gap is extending. So Louis Delatraz now the race leader. Roy Nissany is in second place. And then in third spot, you've got Igor Arutyunov right up behind him. Fourth is Aurelien Panis. Now fifth will be Rene Binder. Tom Dillman is sixth. And there they almost make contact coming down towards the chicane. But a bold effort coming to naught by Igor Arutyunov, because once again, Roy Nissany is just able to fend him off there. Up they come now, together, heading towards the right-hand senior. Is this going to be an opportunity for Arutyunov to have a go? No, but he did think about it, but to no avail. Working their way now through the right-hand turn 11. And this, the run, swoops them round up now to turn 12. A long corner, that, and different lines often employed. But if anything, Roy Nissany is regrouping, isn't he? He's starting to edge away once again relative to Arutyunov, who just hasn't had quite the same sparkle today as he did yesterday. So the field turning its way now up towards Virage Dupont, but what was earlier, the two cars fighting for the race lead, now the two cars fighting for second and third places, because Louis Delatraz goes over the timing line, and the gap that he's got, you can see, is a huge one. It's 7 seconds. So Delatraz, with some great driving and also some very good calls from the pit wall, from the Fortec guys, leads by nearly 7 seconds over Roy Nissany. And Nissany is still losing touch because he's still having to concentrate more on Igor Arutyunov behind him than what's going on up the road. He can't yet think about attacking for the race lead. So the race leader currently on lap number 16. We've still got a quarter of the race to go. Still got 10 more minutes and a lap tagged on at the end. So through they come, lap number 16. Louis Delatraz now just has to make sure that he doesn't make a mistake and, of course, rather crucially, make sure that he looks after the tyres in this final stint of the race. Turns his way now through the chicane, clear of Roy Nissany there. Behind him is Igor Arutyunov. And once more, they power their way onto the Mistral straight, that short continuation up towards senior. Now, what are the sector times like? Delatraz quicker than Nissany and quicker than Arutyunov in sector one. In sector two, Nissany fractionally quicker than Delatraz, but by 25,000th, it doesn't really matter until he's clear of Arutyunov. And only then can he think about doing anything at all about the race leader. So, number seven, Igor Arutyunov. Looking as though, having had his double win yesterday, it's going to be a Louis Delatraz double now, because Louis has already had one outright victory. He's also, of course, going to, if he stays there, win the rookie competition as well. So there's going to be quite a lot to celebrate, I think, at the end of this race, if he can hang on to the advantage. Louis Delatraz then leading the way over the timing line. He leads a few laps ago. He set the fastest lap of the race, and now he's got to be error-free, but largely in 2-litre Formula Renault racing last year, we saw that to be the case. There's no reason to suggest that he's going to start doing silly things now. They're going through Zigor Urushev. And as the cars work their way through lap number 17, the race order then is Delatraz leading Nissani, leading Urushev. Fourth is Panis. Fifth is Binder. In sixth place is Dillman. Seventh is Fittipaldi going strongly. Eighth is Chelis. Ninth now is Janos. In 10th place, it is Kanemaru. 11th is Baitska Visser. 12th is Isakyan, who's certainly qualified better than he's raced. But the real loser in all of this is Mathieu Vatsivier, because it's down in 13th place that you find the driver who was the runner-up in the Formula Renault 3.5 Championship last year. Yesterday, he led the race and then faded, and it was put down to the wrong setup. But there's something not right again. He's only in 13th place. Is it set up again? You'd have thought that overnight the team would have had a long think about it and changed it, but it's just, for whatever reason, again, a poor race for Vatsivier. He was running sixth earlier on. He's not had an off that we've not witnessed, I don't believe, so it's a car problem, seemingly, for Vatsivier, and he's now mired down in 13th place. So, a very, very disappointing weekend for the French driver, coming to his home race and hoping for good things, but it's just not happened for him. So there is Louis Delatraz working his way up now through Virage Dupont into the last 8 minutes of the race. He did come into this type of racing at the end of last year, having mopped up in Formula Renault, because he was the winner of the NEC, the Northern European Cup, last year. He then moved to Formula Renault 3.5 at the end of the season. This year he's been racing for BMW in the German GT Championship and in VLM. And the former Carter and former BMW Talent Cup graduate leading away. In second spot, you've got Roy Nissany. Another man with a good single-seater background, having been in Formula 3 and then Formula Renault 3.5 last year. Igor Urushev, who's also one of the drivers that has been busy in the winter months, because a couple of seasons ago he went to New Zealand to do the Toyota Racing Series across January and February. And that honed his racecraft. Another one-make series of young chargers. So Igor Urushev, fifth in Formula Renault 3.5 last year, not sparkling in the championship yet, but a win and a potential third this weekend will certainly help him. But Delatraz looking so strong now. He's 6.7 seconds to the good. It's come down a bit, but not enough. In 6.5 minutes, even if the tyres start to fade a bit on Delatraz's car, I don't believe it's going to be enough to really be a problem for him, but we shall see. There's Igor Urushev then accelerating his way out of the chicane. Making that run up towards Senior into the right-hander. And as he does so, the race leader, Louis Delatraz, continues to hold sway, continues to make this look very easy indeed. So the field working its way through, and it's a great effort being put in by Fortec, keeping Louis Delatraz in the lead of the race as he works his way then now up once more towards the timing line. Out go the pit boards. And it's all smiles at Fortec. They can sense here the victory coming their way. Down towards turn one goes a frustrated Urushev. The SMP racing car just not quite today being able to do anything about Roy Nissany. Pace just not there. Disappointment compared to what we saw yesterday, where the car looked really, really good. But whether it's a different setup for today, they've gone the wrong way perhaps slightly, but Urushev has never looked as convincing a proposition as he was 24 hours ago. Five more minutes of the race still remain as the field works its way out of turn two. Looking at the battles a little bit lower down the order here. Race order on screen. One person that will be pretty happy with life, I think, today is going to be Pietro Fittipaldi, because after retirement yesterday, here being on target for seventh place will be a very good result, very popular result indeed in the other Fortec car. So Richard Dutton getting all the drivers, or many of the drivers, with a Formula One family connection. Running rookies, as I said earlier on, but successfully so. Down the Mistral Straits, the cars work for the 19th time. Louis Delatraz, race leader, up now through final sequence of corners through Virage du Lac, Virage du Pont at the end of the lap. Then he will sprint his way up towards the timing line. It's all looking pretty good for him at the moment as he works his way up past the pits to put 19 laps in the book. Through he goes. He's starting to tick them off now, isn't he, as he can sense a second win of the year. So through he goes, the championship coming into this race, led by Tom Dillman on 124 points of the 85 of Louis Delatraz. Well, give Louis 25 for his race win. And where is Tom Dillman? Sixth place only. Is it enough to put him into the championship lead? Not yet, but it's going to be a very, very important step forward for Louis Delatraz this, if he wants to try and take the crown, which he assuredly does. Onto the Mistral straight he comes. Fortec, the team run by, owned by Richard Dutton, who himself was no mean driver in junior single-seater racing in the late 1970s. He was a very quick Formula Ford 2000 peddler, for example, Richard Dutton. And then having built up the Fortec empire as a race team with so many different junior single-seater programmes, he's come back into racing himself, Richard, in the last few years, mainly in historic saloon car racing with Lotus Cortinas and Ford Mustangs and the like, against his big mate, engine builder Neil Brown. So these days, Richard can give his drivers a hard time because he's a proper racer once again. He doesn't just do his racing from the pit wall, he gets behind the wheel as well, and is a winner, I have to point out, also in historic touring car racing. So you've got Louis Delatraz with 2 minutes and 15 seconds to go, plus a lap. So he's going to get, I think, three more laps out of the race still. But he's under absolutely no pressure. He's 5.6 seconds ahead of Roy Nissany, and so much of that was done with a clever pit call and some really, really good, brave laps by Delatraz. He pitted early and then pushed on the in lap first of all. As soon as he was released into clear air, pushed and pushed and pushed like it was qualifying, and then that is what has helped him jump into the lead of the race. Second and third go through. Roy Nissany ahead of Igor Rudchev there. So 3 seconds the margin now that Nissany has over Urudchev. By rights, you ought to be smiling, but of course what Lotus weren't able to prevent was the pace of Delatraz when he got onto that fresh rubber. So arguably it was the wrong call to leave Nissany out for as long as the team did, but Delatraz was looking pretty relentless anyway in his pace, and so he's got this healthy advantage. He leads the way, he's on lap 21. Igor Urudchev not as convincing at all as yesterday. Having said that, third, backing up a win yesterday, is still a decent haul of points over the weekend, so he'll be pretty content with that for sure. Delatraz up then towards the exit of the chicane, back to the Mistral straight. So he's going to get back to the timing line before the end of this minute, and therefore there'll be the lap to the end of the time and the regulation lap before the checkered flag comes out. So there's going to be still two more to run for Delatraz. So turns now up through the right-hander at turn 11. He'll get back on the power in a moment, accelerate his way up towards Virage du Lac. And as he accelerates now towards the completion of lap number 21, there's absolutely nobody around him. The gap has come down, though. It was 7 seconds to begin with, then it went to sort of 6 point, and it's now 4.7. So Roy Nissany is upping his pace. He did a personal best last time. Remember, because he stopped later, his tyres are going to be a bit fresher. And over the timing line goes Delatraz now with 2 seconds on the clock. So had he backed off a little bit, yes, Nissany would have been even closer, but he would only have one lap to go, not two. But Nissany on fresher rear tyres now starting to become a little bit more of a threat, because that was another better lap, so 4.2 seconds. At this rate, the gap is going to be close when they come over the timing line for the flag, but I'm not convinced that Roy Nissany is going to get close enough to have a proper bid for the race lead, but it won't be for the lack of trying. He really is hustling on. Personal best lap last time around. And working his way then now down through turn four. There he is. Sorry, that's René Binder, I should say, chasing on behind Aurelien Panis. Fourth and fifth they run. So René Binder, with lots of experience of powerful single-seaters to his name, hanging on to fifth spot. But it's another slightly frustrating race for Lotus, isn't it? Because Roy Nissany did so well early on, but not able to maintain that during the pit stop window. And pushing on now, but is he going to get close enough to Delatraz in time? The gap, as you can see, is coming down. Rudjev running third, but kind of forget about him now. He's not going to be able to catch those ahead, but there is still this question mark over whether or not Roy Nissany is going to be able to do anything at all. How much closer can he get to the race leader before the very end? Out of senior they go for the penultimate time. The clock has hit zero, so at the end of this lap, there will be the regulation one more lap to go. They're turning his way through is Delatraz. So let's have a look this time as they head up towards the line. Where do we stand in terms of a gap? 4.2 seconds it was last time. This lap through, 4.2 will become what? It's 3.9. So that's enough to allow Delatraz not an easy ride home, but a comfortable one. And so the cars work their way now through turn one. The checkered flag is going to be at the ready this time around. And for Louis Delatraz, it's going to be a second win of the year. And he will have worked very, very hard for this one. He may not have had to go wheel to wheel with people out on track. But what he has had to think about is how to manage the tyres all the way through the race at different intervals. And of course, what to do during that pit stop window. And an awful lot of the assistance for that will have come from the Fortec guys on the radio to tell him that he needs to be pushing and pushing and pushing, and it's all worked out. So a very good team effort, which is what this second race is all about. And so it looks as though Louis Delatraz is going to come through in a few moments to score win number two of the year, and of course a second win of the weekend in the rookie category, because he was the best placed rookie yesterday in sixth spot overall. And another rookie win is heading his way here. Very happy dad there, Jean-Denis Delatraz, in the pit lane. So, having been a massive supporter of his son's racing, Jean-Denis, who is often regarded without terribly many compliments because of his limited success in Formula 1, but in GT racing, he was very quick indeed and did win races, so isn't to be ignored as a driver. And Louis Delatraz, though, with a very good future ahead of him, showing perhaps better pace and potential at this point of his career than his father did. Louis has also benefited from some guidance from Alain Menu, the former single-seater star, but then massive touring car legend Alain, who is great mates with Jean-Denis Delatraz. Jean-Denis sponsored Alain for a long, long time, and Alain has helped to guide Louis Delatraz as well. But win number two of the season will go the way of Louis Delatraz. The checkered flag is at the ready. Across the line to win at Paul Ricard goes the Swiss driver. Louis Delatraz wins by 2.8 seconds from Roy Nissany. And then third, a long way back in the end, just now coming over the brow, is Igor Orojev take the final podium place. Aurelien Panis takes fourth. Rene Binder is home for fifth. Sixth goes the way of Tom Dillman. A very happy Jean-Denis Delatraz celebrates his son's second win of the year. Pietro Fittipaldi, his teammate, seventh. Eighth, Alfonso Celis. Ninth should be Arturo Janos. Tenth will be, hopefully, Baitska Visser, because she was ahead at the start of the lap, waiting for the Visser and Kanemaru battle in that order. It finishes to come over the line ahead of Matavossi Sakian, and then Giuseppe Cipriani should be 13th with Mathieu Vectivier. We talked about the fact that there may be a problem for that car. Well, there must have been, because he ended up in the pit lane and did not go back out. So retirement for Vectivier, a very frustrating weekend for him. It should have been so much better on home soil, gaining points. Of course, he led yesterday's race, but in the end, sixth yesterday, fifth yesterday, and retirement today. Very disappointing indeed, and that doesn't help him at all in the championship, especially when Delatraz ends up with a sixth and a win, and Arudjev ends up with a win and a third. So progress to be made. Right, there is Louis Delatraz on the in-lap, celebrating, enjoying the moment, and you could argue that was a more satisfying win than he had first time out in Aragon, because that was without the pit stops. There was the extra dimension of having to push in that pit window, having to think about tyre wear as well, and Delatraz managing all of that very effectively indeed. So making his way offline on the in-lap, making sure he picks up some rubber to add to the weight of the car, thinks about the pickup, and then towards the pit lane. Coming into the race in the championship, Louis second, 85 points, the 1-2-4 of Tom Dillman, but he'll be a little bit nearer in the title race. Tom Dillman only in sixth place. still to come. The cars will be in the UK in July at Silverstone. Then they go to the Red Bull Ring, then Monza, then Jerez, and then Barcelona at the end of the season. So a busy calendar for Formula V8 3.5. And Tom Dillman then, 132 points to the 110 of Louis Delatraz now. So things getting tighter ahead of Aurelien Panis, who is third, up to fourth. Rene Binder up to fifth. Roy Nissany and down to sixth. Mathieu Vexivier, who was fourth overnight ahead of Egor Rudjeff. And then Johnny Giacotto Jr., who I don't think we're going to see again in the championship this year. Budgetary constraints forcing him out. But that is the situation. And of those that lose, Vaxivier is the key. Of those that gain, Delatraz is the real beneficiary. So we'll get a chance, hopefully, to hear from Louis Delatraz once the cars make their way down the pit lane. Blanco de Foronda, who is the media officer for the championship, will be there, hopefully, to speak to our race winner, who knows exactly which board to stop at. He's done it before, and he's done it many times in 2-litre Formula Renault as well. But in the Renault yellow overalls, out gets a delighted Louis Delatraz, punches the air, leaps off the car, and makes his way over to thank the Fortet guys. And Dad is in the background somewhere. There's his father. An extraordinary race, so Jean-Denis, who are we to argue? A great drive by Louis. There's Roy Nissany, who drove probably his best ever race, but still, because of the way that Louis Delatraz and the pit stops went together, didn't come out on top, but not for the want of trying. But you can see how important that win is to Louis Delatraz. Roy Nissany has the good grace to go over and congratulate him, having been mugged on the pit stops, but a great job done by Louis Delatraz. And hopefully we'll get a chance to hear from the race winner in a few moments. Crash helmet off, and what a drive by the Swiss, who looks pretty fresh despite the fact it's been in very high temperatures. So Richard Dutton's team taking a race win. Let's just confirm the result first of all. 23 laps completed. Louis Delatraz the winner. Roy Nissany taking second with Igor Orudchev third. Aurelien Panis fourth ahead of Rene Binder and Tom Dillman. Pietro Fittipaldi seventh. Alfonso Celis eighth. Ninth Arturo Janos. Tenth Bites Kvyat. Yukan Amaru 11th, up from the very back of the grid, and Matevžos Isakyan was 12th. 13th, Giuseppe Cipriani, the only other finisher. So the ones that we lost, Vitor Baptista earlier on, and Mathieu Vexivier, who retired five laps from home. But Louis Delatraz, the man of the moment, scoring win number two of the season. The race is always the same length, but only the second race is the one with the pit stop, so arguably this the more important. And there you can see the sad confirmation of Mathieu Vexivier retiring five laps before the end of the race, and the frustration, not only for the weekend, but for the championship hopes that he had, will be discernible. So it is a win for Louis Delatraz, and he, Roy Nissany and Igor Orudchev will go to the podium. Louis Delatraz, the winning rookie as well, so he's absolutely mopped up. And what was a tremendous drive, we'll let Louis tell all about it, because he is there in Parc Fermé with Blanco de Foronda.
Louis Delatraz, Forte Motorsport, what a massive drive today in the Paul Ricard, your second win.
Yeah, it's really amazing. I mean, the pace was really good. We know since Friday the car is good, and we just made it happen today. The strategy was perfect and the pace as well, so we just have this win, I think.
You made a great undercut, and that, I think, was possibly with the strategy one of the reasons of this win.
Yeah, exactly. We made an undercut because obviously I was blocked behind Egor and I couldn't get past, so we decided to do this. And then I was in fear and could just push flat out for 5-6 lap, and we made it happen.
Rookie championship looks really well. It's the second win, and you're really living that championship as well.
Yeah, the rookie championship is something good. Obviously, I want to win the real championship, and right now I'm second and getting closer to Tom, so we want that and we're going to push, right?
Kind of a home Grand Prix win because the Renault Sport Academy is with you, so kind of celebrating here in France as well.
Exactly, we don't have any track in Switzerland, so France is kind of a home race, and also for Renault Sport Academy and Renault itself, we're really happy.
Congratulations, Lee.
Thank you very much.
So the 19-year-old Swiss driver will make his way now to the podium, and he'll be joined by Roy Nissany and Igor Orudchev. As he does so, let's just look back on some of the highlights of another cracking race here at Paul Ricard. A as the lights went out. A good start made by Arruche from the outside of the front row of the grid, but he couldn't duck in alongside and then take the position away from pole man Roy Nissany. So Nissany led the opening laps with Louis Delatrans in third spot as the cars worked their way around the Paul Ricard circuit. Delatrans was a man on a mission though and was chipping away at the gap to Arruche, getting himself in the mix as they started to get to lap five and the pit stop window. Pietro Fittipaldi battled with Vitor Baptista, who went round the outside of him, diving through Senior and picked up the place. But up front it was Nissany from Arruche with Delatrans doing his best to get in on the mix. Early pit stops among them, Pietro Fittipaldi, he blasted back into the race. But the real key was when Fortec decided to call in Delatrans, because by putting him on new tyres, he was able to make very good progress. Nissany made a mistake, though, out on track whilst leading, and that brought Igor Arruchev much closer to him. As the stops cycle through, Nissany, having stayed out for quite a long time, blasted back into the race behind earlier stopper Delatrans. He was ahead still of Arruchev, but Delatrans then was away and gone. Although the gap came down towards the end, Delatrans managed the situation perfectly. He didn't overstress the tyres, he didn't overdrive the car, and he was able, therefore, to come through for a second win of the year and his first within the pit stop race as well, his first race two victory of the season. So, a win in Spain, a win in France. Louis Delatrans, victorious here. So the drivers are at the podium, and once the championship officials are happy that everybody's ready and correct, then they'll be brought forward at the end of the eighth round of Formula V8 3.5, this Spanish organised championship, continuing to be strong, continuing to be successful, and continuing, more importantly perhaps, to deliver great racing and finding drivers with a very good future indeed. And with top single-seater teams like Durango, like Fortec, like Arden, for example, then it should have a very good future. It has a great track record, a great pedigree. It's from this that the likes of Sebastian Vettel and Carlos Sainz and also Robert Kubica came, among many, many others. And there is Olivier Panis, whose son Aurélien was fourth today, but he's going to present the trophies. And not only a proud dad, but also sports car team owner Olivier Panis makes his way on to the podium, ready to hand trophies to third place Igor Arruchev. Richard Dutton looks on proudly as the owner of the winning Fortec team, as up to the podium goes Roy Nissany, and then the top step will be taken by Louis Delatrans for a second outright win of the year. Yesterday he was the winning rookie. Today, not only is he the winning rookie, he is the winner. And a very happy Swiss driver is atop the podium here at Paul Ricard. And then Fortec also represented on the podium as the winning team. And that offers the chance for the national anthem for the winning driver. Delatrans on the top step for a second outright win of the year receives the applause from those below, and shortly we'll receive a winner's trophy and a rookie winner's trophy as well. And Olivier Panis now steps forward to give the third place trophy to Igor Arruchev. He'd much rather, I'm sure, be giving it to his son, but Aurélien was fourth, the first of those off the podium. But a third place trophy to go to his winner's trophy of yesterday for Igor Arruchev. Roy Nissany takes a second of the year, and the happy man as for the top step, it's going to be Louis Delatrans then, who now gets the winner's trophy and punches the air once again. A very happy man. It's not only the win that's important, but it's also brought him much nearer in the title race. Roy Nissany, three second places, apologies, now he's had. And there's the winning rookie trophy as well for Louis Delatrans. What a drive by the young Swiss racer. Now they'll get together on the top step of the podium for the photographs, all being well, and there'll be some champagne, I fear, offered in their direction as well. Fortec gets the team's trophy, And also there's the award from Michelin as well for Louis Delatraz, who got the fastest lap of the race, lest you forget. So not quite the triple whammy. He didn't get pole position, but he didn't get anything else wrong, did he, over the course of the race. And so Delatraz, victorious. Roy Nassani, again, the bridesmaid. 3 second places now this year. And then as Fortec can wallow in the delight of Louis Delatraz's victory, they all huddle together on the top step. And Igor Arutyunov in the red, white and blue SMP Racing colours, the Russian team at the other end of the podium, yesterday's race winner. So Fortec, a delighted team, the British squad, and now the champagne, I think, is about to be sprayed. Louis Delatraz victorious here at Paul Ricard. And to say thank you to the Fortec team, soak your engineer, seems perfectly fair. A clink of the bottle, and then the drivers will make their way off to the press conference with Louis Delatraz, having set himself up in that race as a real threat in the championship. So the series heads to the UK, to Silverstone in the weekend of July 23-24, a chance to see the cars in the UK, and then to the Red Bull Ring, then Monza, then Jerez, and then Barcelona before the end of the season. But from Paul Ricard, we've had some great racing from Formula V8 3.5, and the championship situation closer than it was coming into this weekend. It's going to be a fascinating end to the season. The story continues for now from Paul Ricard, from David Addison. Bye-bye.